The Volkswagen XL1 was born out of a simple question. Can we make a practical car that can cover 100 kilometres on just 1 litre of fuel? That's a lofty goal. It's a car that can do 280 miles per Imperial gallon. It was created at a time when Volkswagen CEO Ferdinand Piëch was challenging his team to new heights. The Bugatti Veyron would be the fastest car in the world, the Volkswagen Phaeton would be an affordable luxury limousine, and the XL1 would push fuel economy boundaries to their limit. So, did Volkswagen succeed? Is it possible to create a practical car that can do 280 miles per gallon? This is the Volkswagen XL1 story. Fuel economy has always been important. Relative to inflation, fuel has remained relatively static, but it's always seemed to be more and more expensive. It's an environmental disaster, so any company that can reduce the amount of fuel they need to put into a tank, the more cars they can sell. This wasn't the first time Volkswagen had made a tiny fuel-efficient car. In 1986, they unveiled the scooter concept. The three-wheeled two-seater used a 1 litre engine to get nearly 55 miles per gallon. But in the late 1990s, Volkswagen CEO Ferdinand Piëch was blowing the budget on new projects to push Volkswagen to new heights. He kicked off the supercar Bugatti Veyron project and Phaeton limousine, and challenged his engineers to come up with a car that could go 100 kilometres on a litre of fuel. This was uncharted territory. There had been experimental cars such as solar-powered EVs, but as far as regular passenger cars went, the best had come from the likes of the 2000 Honda Insight with an impressive 73 miles per gallon. Volkswagen were masters of diesel engines, and they would go on to show how powerful yet frugal their engines were when Audi's diesel-powered R10 won the 2006 24 Hours of Le Mans. So it made sense to power their initial design with a diesel. But with such a radical goal, the team had to use a minute 300cc, 8 horsepower, 1-cylinder fuel-injected engine coupled to a 6-speed automatic transmission. This would power the car to 75 miles an hour, but it wasn't going to be burning anyone off the traffic lights anytime soon. Of course, low drag cars have been tried before, and as car designers learnt more about reducing drag, these cars got better at punching as small a hole as possible through the air. Volkswagen took drag reduction to the next level. Its car would put the passenger behind the driver to make the car narrower, and covered rear wheels would be closer together to create a wind-cheating teardrop shape. Door mirrors would slow the car down too much, so were replaced by cameras, and the underside of the car was covered to be as smooth as possible. The Toyota Prius had a drag of 0.25, the GM EV1 an impressive 0.19, but the Volkswagen's drag would be just 0.16. Modern racing cars focus on saving weight, and this car was no different. Ultra-lightweight, expensive carbon fibre-reinforced plastic body panels would be used over an equally expensive magnesium alloy subframe. The panels wouldn't use any paint to save weight. Like a modern racing car, every part was pared down, and the final car came in at just 290 kilograms. For comparison, the Volkswagen Polo of that time weighed almost 4 times as much. Even the Volkswagen badge was painted on to minimise drag and weight. Volkswagen wasn't messing around here. Getting in involved opening the roof, and the whole car had an air of the 1950s Messerschmitt KR200 about it. Inside it was a little rudimentary, but this was a working prototype after all, and it used switchgear from other cars in the VW range. Seats were, of course, made from magnesium to save weight. Despite all this weight savings, the car featured ABS and a driver's airbag. It also included a rear view camera, as looking behind you while reversing was out of the question. The car was launched in 2002, with CEO Piëch himself driving the car from VW's offices in Wolfsburg to the annual shareholder meeting in Hamburg. The fuel tank couldn't hold more than a gallon and a half, but it didn't need to. He covered the 143-mile trip using less than half a gallon, although Piëch himself was hypermiling it a bit with an average speed of just 46 miles an hour. This was all very well, but like many concept cars such as this Angry Frog and its boxy follow-up, it wasn't all that practical, and so wasn't going to go into production. The press took note, wrote write-ups praising VW for their achievement, and then went back to testing cars people actually drive. But VW continued with their task to making something more practical, and Piëch announced in 2007 that the car would be ready in 3 years. With the world going gaga about hybrid technology in the early 2000s, this car would be an ideal candidate to use it. The new concept, dubbed the L1, would be a turbo diesel hybrid. The engine chosen was Volkswagen's 1.6 litre four-cylinder diesel, but it would be lopped in half to become an 800cc 39 horsepower two-cylinder. This would be coupled with a 14 horsepower electric motor and lithium-ion batteries that would act as the engine's starter motor. This made it easier to add automatic start-stop technology that would help improve fuel economy around town rather than when it's driven at a steady 56. Volkswagen would retain the two-seat arrangement with the passenger behind and the canopy opening, but it would be a little bit longer and taller. OLED screens and LED lights would save both weight and power. The body panels still use carbon fibre, but with VW learning to make carbon fibre structures cheaper, the monocoque would also use this material with an aluminium crash structure. A car usually has a gaping grille to cool the engine. With the engine behind the driver, a grille wasn't needed, but ducts to cool the engine would open electronically when required, a feature carried over from the 2002 prototype. A new shape gave the car an impressive 0.195 drag coefficient, but with the addition of that electric motor and batteries, the car had put on 90 kilograms of weight. VW had always pitched their 2002 prototype as a car that could do 100 kilometers on 1 liter of fuel, but the new L1 prototype missed this by a long way. Where the 2002 prototype could get 285 miles per gallon, this car could only get 190. Still impressive, but a big reduction. However, with that larger engine and electric motor, the top speed was almost 100 miles an hour with respectable acceleration, and the larger 2.2 gallon tank meant the car had a 416 mile range. When the L1 was launched in 2009, VW were keen to say it would be developed and was close to production in 2013. Yes, yes, we've heard it all before. Yet, in 2011, VW released the improved XL1 prototype that they continued to insist would be a production vehicle. Befitting a futuristic car, it was launched in a suitably futuristic location, in this case, the Qatar Motor Show in Doha. The updated car was a big step forward. Gone was the awkward seating arrangement, with both driver and passenger entering through their own butterfly doors. This was a far more practical seating arrangement, and the staggered seating added just 47 centimetres to the car's width. The car's drag factor had lowered to 0.186, similar to the GM EV1 from 10 years earlier. The L1 engine was carried forward, but power had been increased. The electric motor had also got a boost, and it could power the car on its own for 22 miles. The plug-in diesel hybrid engine had suspiciously impressive low emissions and complied with EU6 emission standards. The XL1 wasn't the only small fuel-efficient prototype Volkswagen would show in 2011. They also unveiled the one-seater NILS EV concept, which also had a bit of a Messerschmitt vibe about it. This car would be pure electric vehicle with a small range, but with much more practical cars such as the Nissan Leaf already released, not much more was heard about this tiny vehicle. By 2012, the XL1 design was finalised, and Volkswagen announced it would go into production the following year. It would also get creature comforts such as air conditioning. But the big news was the all-important fuel economy figures, the whole reason why this car had been developed in the first place. Despite it being double the weight of the L1, it would use just 0.9 litres per 100 kilometres, an impressive 310 miles per gallon. So how did a car that was twice as heavy as the L1 get better fuel economy? Well, in short, it didn't. Volkswagen did a little massaging of the figures. It presumed that the larger battery pack that could get 31 miles of range was recharged every 47 miles. By that logic, all electric cars get an infinite mile per gallon figure. But once owners got their hands on it, in real-world tests the car managed a still impressive 120 miles per gallon. So even though it couldn't be said that Volkswagen truly hit their target, they created an impressive car that got better fuel economy than maybe any other regular passenger car. XL1 production began in 2013, being limited to just 250 cars, and sales were limited to Europe. The car wasn't road legal in other parts of the world because of things like not having physical door mirrors. Prices of this special car were very special, at £98,000. If you want to save the planet, you better have deep pockets. But despite the high prices, the car was oversubscribed. The first car arrived in 2014, with the last being delivered in 2016. If you want one today, a couple are available for extraordinary prices. There was one coda to the XL1 story. In 2014, Volkswagen produced another XL1 concept as the XL1 Sport. This car wasn't focused on fuel economy, but performance. The 200 horsepower 1.2 litre engine from the Ducati Paninelli V2 motorbike was fitted, giving this low drag car a 0-60 time of 5.7 seconds and a top speed of 167 miles an hour. But VW was clear at the time that this was just a concept. Volkswagen turned its back on developing diesel engine technology further with the Dieselgate scandal just 1 year later, and since then they focused on electric vehicles. With VW's push to create extraordinary cars, we may yet see more cars that push the boundaries of what's possible. A big thank you to all my patrons for supporting me. To get early advert-free access to new videos or to appear in the credits, please consider supporting me using the Patreon link below from just $1 or 80p a month, and hit that subscribe button to get notified of new videos. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next video.